أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله الله أكبر لا إله إلا
السماء إله وفي الأرض إله يعلم سركم ونجواكم ويعلم ما تبدون وما تكتمون وما يخفى على الله من شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء الحمد لله الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات ربنا لك الحمد حتى ترضى ولك الحمد إذا رضيت ولك الحمد بعد الرضا صلى اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيد الأولين والآخرين محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له الملك الحق المبين أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صفيه من خلقه وخليله وأمينه على وحيه يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون في respected brothers and sisters in Islam, all praise and glory and thanks are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all that He has given us. وَإِن تَعُدُّ نَعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا وَإِن تَعُدُّ نَعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance and for help and for health and for protection and for forgiveness. Let me just remind all of us that whatever we have is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. And whatever you need is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to intensify our supplication and dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill to get our needs fulfilled. Dear respected brother and sister in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the end of Surah Al-Mu'minun says, أَتَحَسَبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ Do you think that we created you for no reason? Or do you think that you are not accountable for your action? This verse tells you the two main reasons that lead people astray. When they forget why they're here, and then when they forget that they're accountable for their actions. When they forget why they're here, and then when they forget why they are accountable for their, that they are accountable for their action. So the question that we should be asking ourselves all the time, why we're here? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought us to this life? Why this question is important? Because that's how you're going to be evaluated. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for a specific job, for a specific reason, for a specific mission. And then our performance will be evaluated. We're going to be held accountable. So we have to be always, remind ourselves again why we are here. And if you ask, do we know, first of all, what are we supposed to do in this life? And I'm not sure we do. I'm not sure that most Muslims, or at least many Muslims, they are not really fully aware of what they are supposed to do in this life. And if we ask people, if we distribute papers on Muslims and ask what is your mission in life, you're going to get all kinds of all different answers. So we have to focus on this, make an effort to know why I'm here, so that I will do what I'm supposed to do, so that I'm prepared to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to summarize the mission of a believer, yani Risalat al-Muslim fil Hayat, in one sentence, is ma'rifat wa infad muradillah, knowing and fulfilling the purpose or the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowing, ma'rifat wa infad muradillah. That's the life of the believers. Hayat al-Muslim is centered around this, that you will always try to learn and try to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects you to do and wants you to do. Try to learn, there is knowledge, ma'rifa, and there is action, knowing and doing. All our life we should be learning more and doing more for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learning more and doing more. Learning what? What is it that we're supposed to learn? Learning, knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. We have to make an effort to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ma'rifatullah. There is no way you can be a good servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you don't know him very well. You want to be a good servant of Allah, abd lillah azza wa jal, you should make an effort to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Most of us, our knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very superficial. And for a very simple reason, we didn't make the effort. So we need to make an effort to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very well. How do we do that? Practically. You can do this by, one, by learning the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Asma'ullahi wa sifat. You know them, you learn them, you understand them. That's a very good way to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. من أحصاها الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم سيدخل الجنة. أسماء الله, you know them very well, and of course you apply them. You know them and you act upon them. That's a very good way, because these names tells you about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The names of mercy, the name of forgiveness, the names of power, all names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you know them very well, your knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase. Very practically, if you learn two names a week, in 1 year you can finish them. Everybody can do this. Two names a week, by yourself or with your family, you can finish in 1 year learning all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Second way to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Quran. Most of the Quran is about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about himself, tells us what he likes, what he doesn't like. Most of the Quran is about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if your relationship with the Quran is good, that will make your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala good. If your relationship with the Quran is good, meaning that you read the Quran regularly and you read it properly. Many people don't read the Quran at all, but many people do read the Quran. But not many people read the Quran regularly. That's one problem. And then among those who read the Quran regularly, not many of them, they read it properly. What is the proper way to read the Quran? First of all, you should not be reading the Quran for ajr. You should be reading the Quran for guidance, for instructions. The ajr will come, inshallah. But you should be reading the Quran for guidance, to learn something that you can apply in your life. And the ajr, inshallah, will be there. Why this is important? Because if you read the Quran for ajr, only. You would be focusing on the quantity, how many pages. You should focus on the quantity, even if you don't understand much. But if you read the Quran for guidance, then you will focus on understanding. So you read the Quran regularly, daily, hopefully. It doesn't matter how much you read. Everybody's schedule is different. Even if it is one verse a day, regularly, two verses, half a page a day. But you do it with reflection and contemplation. You read the verse and you ask yourself, what does it mean? How does it apply to me? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about something good, you check yourself. If this sifa, if this feature applies to you, you should be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you should keep it. Example, you come and read Surah Al-Mu'minun in the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, successful are the believers. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. When you read this, the Quran properly, the question that should come to your mind is what? What these people are doing so that Allah is saying about them they are successful. And you start applying the criteria one by one. الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Okay, how is my khushu'ah in salat? Is it good? Did it work? So that's how you read Quran. It's an interaction. It's you see yourself in the mirror. If you find something good that applies to you, alhamdulillah, keep it. Thank Allah for it and keep it. If you find something good that does not apply to you, then that's your homework for the week. You find something that Allah likes, but it does not apply to you. So you know that this week, that's what I'm going to be working on. And the same thing goes for things that Allah does not like. If Quran mentioned, you're reading the Quran and you come across something that Allah does not like, if you are not doing, alhamdulillah, you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you are not doing this bad thing. But if you're doing it, that's the work that needs to be done. You need to work on it to get rid of it. It's a bad habit, you want to get rid of it. Imagine you reading the Quran regularly and reading it this way. Every day you become a better Muslim and a better person. Every day. Every day something will change in you. Every day is something in you that something good that you're going to add, and there is some bad habits that you're going to get rid of. So that's another way to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His names and attributes and through the Quran. These are the most effective ways to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why this is important? Because whoever knows Allah loves Him. من عرف الله أحبه. If you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you love Him. The more you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you become motivated to worship and serve. Now many of us, we worship because we have to. We worship just when I avoid punishment. We still, maybe many of us, I don't know how many of us experience worshiping out of love. Worshiping because you like to do it. It's not because you have to. That's the worship of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to enjoy praying. It's not like a burden that just get rid of it or put it out of the way. وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his utmost pleasure was when he's praying. He can go on and on because he's really enjoying it. He's enjoying praying. Nowadays, sometimes you see people praying so fast just to get rid of it. Enjoy praying. So that's the quality. I mean, the more you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you love Him. The more you become motivated to worship and serve. And you keep doing this until you reach a point where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلْ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. And when you reach that point, you got it made. When you get to the point where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you, then He will put a blessing, barakah, in your time, in your wealth, will guide you to the best choices, to the best decisions, will protect you in this life. You will be protected and guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will see with the lights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is It is a work that needs to be done. When you become a Muslim, it's the beginning, it's not the end. It's the beginning of journey. There is still a lot of work that you should be doing. So knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very essential if we want to do the job right. Just to bring the idea closer, if you are in a company, the more you know the boss, the better you can do the job. You know what he expects, what he likes, what he doesn't like. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. The more you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the better servant you become. Because then you know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects you to do and wants you to do, and you're going to do it. So knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and these are practical ways of doing it. What is, again, our mission in life? Ma'rifat wa intad muradillah. Knowing and fulfilling or executing the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what it means to become abd. A non-believer will do what he likes. A believer does what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes. That's the complete submission. You surrender and you become someone who does وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It's not fitting for a believing man or woman if Allah and His Messenger decree something to have a choice of their own. There is no second thought. إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. There is no second thought. There is no reluctance. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. I'm there. Whatever Allah wants you to be, you are there. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects you to do, you do it. And some of you probably know the hadith that on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be asking person, saying, I was sick and you did not come to see me. And the person say, how come you are Rabbil Alameen and you become sick? Say, no, my servant. Didn't you know that my servant or your brother was sick and you did not go to visit him? If you went, you will find me there. If you went to visit him, you will find me there. Means that you were expected to be there and you were not, you were missing. You were expected, and the hadith goes on and say, I asked you for food and you didn't give me. Say, oh, how come Rabbil Alameen, I give you food? I say, but my servant was hungry. There is somebody who was hungry. And you are expect, I mean, the meaning of the hadith is that there are Allah expects you to do things and to be in a certain place at a certain time. You have to be there. You become a Muslim, you are committed to be whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be and to do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects you to do. That requires knowledge and that requires determination, discipline. Sometimes we know what we're supposed to do, but we are weak. Probably many of you come across, sometimes you talk to somebody, say, why you're not praying? Say, I know I have to pray, I'm weak. Or why you're drinking? I know it's bad, I have to stop, but I can't. That's somebody who knows what is right and wrong, but doesn't do it. So it requires knowledge, and it requires also determination and discipline and willpower. And this is the attitude of the believer. You are always learning, and whatever you learn, you apply. With no hesitation and with no reluctance. That's the attitude of the companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what you're going to be asked on the day of judgment. It's not enough on the day of judgment to come with prayer and fasting, etc. It's not enough. The question, did you do what you were supposed to do? Did you do what you were created to do? It's a big mission, it's a big job. That's a job for which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent prophets before. Now it is assigned to you and me. That's our job. It's the job of the prophets. It's an honor for us to be the instrument that do Allah's work. Allah is in no need for us. But it is an honor that He has given us to be the one who will execute His will and execute His plan and put it into effect. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, says, وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ لَكَ وَلِقَوْمِكَ وَسَوْفَ تُسْأَلُونَ. That this deen, this mission, it's an honor for you and for your people. And you'll be held accountable. It's an honor and it is a responsibility. So we're going to have to take our deen very seriously. This is the mission that was assigned to prophets before. This is the mission that scared the mountains and the skies and the earth. إن عرضنا الأمانة على السماوات والأرض والجبال فأبينا أن يحملنها. It's huge. It's big. And you have limited time to do it. It's not open-ended. Time can be up at any moment. I'm sure many of you, every now and then, you find yourself deleting some phone numbers of people who are gone from your contact lists. Because if this can happen any moment. Today you're deleting the name of somebody, tomorrow people will be deleting your name. And it can come with no warning. So we have to be always prepared for it. Now we know that from last Jum'ah to this Jum'ah, we have 1 week less to live, that's for sure. But how much is left, we don't know. So when you think about to do something good, do it right now. Never allow shaitan to tell you next week or next month or next day. There might be no other day. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتٌ. So it's a big job, it's limited time. And then you know that there is an enemy after you, whose mission is what? To make you fail. And I strongly recommend to read the stories of the creation of Adam alayhi salam, story of Adam and Iblis. Read what Iblis was saying. قال أرأيتك هذا الذي كرمت علي لأحتنكن ذريته إلا قليلا ثم لا أتينهم بين أيديهم ومن خلفهم وعن أيمانهم وعن شمائلهم ولا تجد أكثرهم شاكرين لا أقعدن لهم صراطك المستقيم. I will block the straight path for them. لأغوينهم أجمعين إلا عبادك منهم المخلصين. It's a very serious. Somebody, if we relax, he doesn't. He works 24/7, no distraction, very focused on his mission. His mission is exactly the opposite of yours. You want to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be a good servant, to succeed in this life. He wants to destroy you and mislead you. So that requires also us to be very vigilant, to be awake all the time and not to allow anything to distract us. Plus, not only the job is big, not only time is limited, not only there is an enemy after us, but also the stakes are very high. Stakes, I mean, this is not a job that you lose, you can get another one. This is not an exam that you fail, you can take it again. This is between the heaven, Jannah, and the unthinkable rewards. فِيَ مَا لَعَيْنٌ لَرَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ بَالِ بَشَرَ. And it's beyond imagination. So the rewards are beyond imagination. The punishment is beyond imagination. And there is nothing in between. And don't allow shaitan to fool you to say it's just a few days of punishment and then we'll move on. قَالُوا لَنْ تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودًا. That's a shaitan's trick. There is no such thing. What you should be targeting, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, when you ask for the Firdaus. You ask for the highest level in paradise. What you want to aim for is to be admitted to heaven without hisab. That's your target. It's not just to pass. It's not just to look for the minimum. It's to get the highest, to get the place in the highest level of heaven. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us in this life to compete. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا أَحْسَنُ. Who is the best? And no matter how good you are, always keep in mind that you are in competition. And you are in competition with very good people. There are very great people in history of Islam. These are the ones that you're competing with. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. So there is a competition with people and there is a race against the clock. The clock is ticking. We cannot stop it. That's why when it comes to maghfirah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مَرَبِّكُمْ وَسَابِقُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مَرَبِّكُمْ. Race, rush, compete for the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's keep this in mind. No matter how good your worship is, keep in mind that the standard is what? The standard is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And don't listen to shaitan or to anybody say you can't compare yourself to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You should compare yourself to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's the meaning of him being qudwa, uswa. Meaning that's the standard. You know, students are graded out of 100. You are graded out of the performance of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So your salah is evaluated compared to the salah of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Your manners, no matter how good your khuluq, your manner is, you know that there is a room to improve. Why? Because the standard is the khuluq of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he says something great, means it is really great. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. No matter how much you're doing for Allah, for this deen, and for this community, and for the sake of Allah, remember that you're comparing to the dedication of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who for 23 years, since the time he became a prophet, till the time he passed away, he did not rest. Day in, day out, fulfilling the mission that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala selected him to do, which is our mission. It is our mission. He was just sent to show us how to do it and to keep always comparing to the standard. So keep in mind the high expectation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the high standard of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that you'll be always motivated, always trying to be a better person, always trying to learn more, always trying to do more. وَتُوبِ اللَّهِ إِنَّا غَفُرُونَ. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه. نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. My dear respected brother and sister in Islam, there is a lot of work is needed from us, and we should not accept the situation we are in. I mean, we can't be an ummah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expected to be the best, expected to be leading, expected to be a model community, and we find ourselves in the way behind. That's not acceptable. It happened, fine. It happened. We just have to understand why we ended up in this situation and find out how we can rebound. It's never too late. This deen worked in conditions much worse than ours. This deen was revealed on people who were poor. We have much more resources than they did. They were illiterate, most of them. They were short in numbers. It was a tribal society fighting each other all the time. This is the condition in which Islam was revealed. And what Islam made out of these people? Made out of these people, champions of great civilizations and leader of the world. That's how powerful our deen is. That's how great our deen is. So we never lose hope, and we should never accept this reality. Islam could produce the same results now as it did in those days. What is needed? People who are serious. People, it's level of commitment, the level of dedication, and the level of discipline. So it is in your hand. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not help people who don't help themselves. Only when you exhaust all the means and you fall short, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of the rest. Not before. Anything that you can do, Allah will not do it for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes care only of things that are beyond you. So when Muslims, they do everything they can and they fall short, Allah will take care of the rest. وَأُخْرَ لَن تَقْدِرُ عَلَيْهَا قَدْ أَحَاطَ اللَّهُ بِهَا. But not before that. So let's not fool ourselves thinking that somehow some help is not going to come. إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرْكُمْ. The help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is conditional. So it's bad. Situation is very bad nowadays. You look at the map of the Muslim world, it's getting almost worse every day, but it's not hopeless. Again, it's in our hands. It's our hand. The formula is there. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. We change the way we think, the way we do things, our priorities, our level of commitment, our level of dedication, and we do everything right, and we do everything we can, and then if we fall short, we can count on the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which
makes all the difference. إِنْ يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ. I mean, nobody can stop you. But again, that help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is conditional. So let us keep this in our minds and in our discussion, why we ended up in this situation, what does it take to rebound and be in the position that Quran described the community of believers, كُنْتُمْ لِتَكُونُ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. That's the role of believers. الَّذِينَ إِنْ مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنكَرِ. Muslims, wherever they settle, they make a difference. Muslims are difference makers. They are not just, they don't make a living, they make a difference. الَّذِينَ إِنْ مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ, wherever they settle, أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنكَرِ. So again, we have the guidance, we have the model of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we have everything, whatever it takes, it just need the, what is missing now, what is missing is the commitment, the willpower, is really to want to change our situation. We should be ashamed that we ended up with 1.5 billion Muslims and almost totally irrelevant in this world, while some few dozens of Muslims were able to change the world. The people who changed the world are less than the people in this room. The people with the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam who changed this world are less than the people who are praying in this room. So you can imagine, it's the quality, it's the dedication, seriousness, commitment that it takes, and again, it is never too late. There are many nations in history who found themselves in a much worse situation than ours, but they were able to rebound, and now they are way ahead of us. And we keep seeing nations jumping in front of us, and we are in the same position. Again, that's not something that will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah loves to see His servant, His community, the community of believers in the forefront, in a leading position, and as a model community. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا توفنا وانت راض عنا واختم بالصالحات أعمالنا واجعل خير أعمالنا خواتمها وخير أيامنا من ألقاك ومتعنا اللهم بالنظر إلى وجهك الكريم. ربنا ارحم آباءنا وأمهاتنا كما ربونا صغارا وارحم موتانا وجميع موتى المسلمين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في جمعنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا حاجة هي لك رضا إلا قضيتها. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين. صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح. قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر الله أكبر. لا إله إلا الله.